G'day guys and gal. In your life, you will achieve many things. You will help people. You will make people laugh, smile, give them hope and give them meaning. And maybe, just maybe, one or two of you might even make a girl come. However, nothing you do in your life will ever even amount to the significance of a cum stain on a public toilet when compared to the achievements of a Primarch. Should you feel bad about this? No, because they aren't real. But more importantly, they were born with slick special superpowers. As we know, each Primarch has their special Primarch sauce. Stuff like super strength, intelligence, and willpower are the basic guidelines to make a demigod. However, Primarchs are more than that, with each Primarch having a number of their own little spicy powers that are completely unique to them. Some of these are pretty obvious, like Magnus's war powers or Leman's concerning obsession with wolves. However, others are a lot more subtle. Did you know that Fulgrim's regeneration is significantly faster than all the other Primarchs bar Vulcans? Bet you didn't know that, which means this video is valuable to you. It's not that valuable, but still a little bit, so keep watching. Lads and lady, it's been an incredible year, and it's awesome to see that we're still having great growth and momentum, but Arch needs to eat our dust, and he's got to do it now. So if you laugh, smile, learn something new, or hope democracy prevails in Myanmar, then consider hitting that juicy red button. I have something a little cheeky planned for when we overtake Arch that I know you'll like. Today we'll go over each of the Primarch's unique abilities, providing examples of when they were used and how powerful those abilities were. This is all going to be before Chaos claimed half the Primarchs, so Angron having demon wings or Fulgrim having like 8 tits doesn't count. Let's get into it. Starting us off with Primarch number 1, because chronological order is a vibe. We have the Lion L. Johnson. Now, Mr. Johnson is a space knight, which is already awesome, but not necessarily a special power, even though all of his other powers kind of stem from that. Firstly, he's a god-tier swordsman and duelist, able to fight without conscious thought. He can change sword swings mid-swing based on gut instinct, which is why he was able to beat Conrad Curse in a fair duel, despite Conrad being able to see the future. Conrad would foresee a downward slice, prepare to counter, then the lion's instinctual power would detect the counter before it happened, and it would change the slice to a sideways one, hence cutting out a chunk of deranged Batman. Yet Conrad wasn't a huge fan of that ability. Whilst the lion isn't explicitly a psyker, his spirit is very prominent. It's very how you doing. As he grew up in a chaos monster infested forest, where he hunted mutated demon beasts for fun, he had grown extremely resistant to chaos. So much so that when Kairos Fateweaver, who like knows everything, came to the lion to try turn him to chaos, he realized that there was absolutely nothing he could say or do that would even make the lion hesitate. Then the lion fucked him up and sent him back to hell. Another example of the lion's obscene fortitude is when a million-year-old super psycho Xeno invaded his mind, which is, you know, something it specializes in and has been training to do for a million years. However, the lion was just able to fuck the Xeno to death with pure willpower. This enhanced spirit and willpower even allows the lion to maybe permakill demons, and it gives him more presence than even Horus. Loyalty is its own reward. On to number 2 now, we have one of the missing Primarchs, whose superpower is his ability to play hide and seek. Still haven't found him. Number 3 is everyone's favourite pedo snake, Fulgrim. Fulgrim's power was the fact that he was pretty. No, like I'm serious. When he was found after crash landing on the planet, the people were like, "We cannot feed this boy, let's kill him." But then they were like, "Oh no, he's hot." So they let him live. Fulgrim doesn't have too many special abilities, which, you know, shows. But one thing people often overlook is his insane regeneration powers, even compared to other Primarchs. Like, he gets shot in the eye with an extremely high caliber sniper rifle, something which would definitely kill or at least severely maim a lot of the other Primarchs, and he just kinda walks it off. Once when he was doing a ritual where he needed to have shit carved into his flesh, he had to focus on slowing down his healing factor because the carvings kept healing before the ritual could be finished. But yeah, Fulgrim's a fucking dipshit for picking up that sword. On to number 4, we have Perturabo, who was given some kinda shit superpowers that he resented a lot. Like, it seems as if the Emperor was just taking the piss here. Basically, Perty can always see the Eye of Terror, which sucks because it's not a nice thing to look at, especially when he was young and didn't know what it was. It seemed like an evil god was staring at him all the time, which made him super paranoid. Another power, which seems good but kinda isn't, is that Purdy inherently understands almost everything. He can look at something and automatically figure out what it is, how it's made and how it works, and how to improve it. There is no joy of discovery or learning for him. Poor Bubba. Another thing, which he added in himself, but will still count, is that he basically put a computer in his head, which allows him to view and play battles like an RTS game. The more I learn about Perturabo, the more I realize there is a Perturabo in all of us. Rather that than a Fulgrim in me, Numel 5 is Jagadai Khan. Other than being the token Asian, Jagadai is incredibly fast. Like, he is the speed. He can tap into the speed force to go Super Saiyan speed in times of rage. Like, one time, one of his space marines died, and he got so mad that he began killing orcs so fast and viciously that the orcs weren't even enjoying it at all and they wanted to run. That's right, the Khan was so fast that he made orcs dislike fighting. The Khan is also able to kill ghosts, which is, you know, a bit random, but it still counts. A final note is that Jagadai is arguably the most reasonable out of all the Primarchs. Like, when the heresy broke out and he listened to both sides' arguments, he was like,
"Traitors, I understand where you are coming from. Father is a dickhead, a tyrant, but you guys are fighting for demons of hell, so I am not going to join you."
That's probably the most reasonable way to look at it, in my opinion. On to number 6, we have the Leman of Russ, the Wolf King, the man who howls unironically. Now, the obvious one here is the Canix Helix, which gives Russ increased savagery, heightened senses, sharper teeth, and huge resistance to the warp. Like, some space wolves will allow themselves to become wolfen so that they can withstand huge amounts of chaos without falling. Whilst Russ is anti-psyker, he can still tap into his spirit and communicate with the warp and scry using runes and other definitely not warp powers. Russ can also let out a warp disrupting howl, which he did so to Magnus in order to help overpower Magnus before fucking up his back. Number 7 gives us the rogueliest of Dawns. Having lots of special powers doesn't make a Primarch better or more impactful. The fact that Dawn only has one subtle power, that being his ability to silence and push back the warp with his willpower, doesn't mean he is weaker than Perturabo, who has like 4 or 5 powers. In fact, it's the opposite. By Rogel not having innate OP powers, he has to work harder to improve himself, hence why he's a top tier swordsman, commander, and an all-round dude, even compared to the rest of the Primarchs. On to number 8, we have Space Batman, with extra bats and no sense of morality or likability. Conrad Curse. Conrad is a good example of having too many powers, as it has literally broken his mind. He has an incredibly powerful precognitive ability, able to see events years in the future or mere seconds away. A downside to this is that his visions were harsh and they hurt his brain. As he got better at using it, it also caused more damage to his sanity. He foresaw the Horus Heresy and the death of various Primarchs years ahead of time, and he could also use his power to time when to jump out of his ship so he wouldn't die. Another power of his is his stealth abilities. He can merge with shadows and become nearly invisible. It's not as good as Korax's invisibility, but it's still decent and it helps him pull off some gnarly ambushes. But yeah, I'd take a working brain over that shit any day. Number 9 is the Space Angel, who also had solid cognitive abilities, but he wasn't a whiny little bitch about it, Sanguinius. Now, before we get into Sangy's foresight, let's address the elephant in the room. Motherfucker has wings. He uses those wings to fly, but also kinda not. See, his wings, according to physics, are not enough to get him off the ground. Hence, he is flying using warp magic, and his wings are just there to make it not look weird. His foresight is slightly less powerful than Conrad's, but it doesn't scramble his brain. It works in a very similar way. Sanguinius foresaw his death well into the future, but he also foresaw that a duel that he was about to have with Curse could kill either of them, hence he didn't proceed with it. Another less known power of Sangy's was his ability to bend reality to his will in subtle ways. When his flagship is crashing and should be breaking up and exploding, he wills it to survive the crash, and he basically holds the ship together through manifesting his desired reality. His duel with Horus is another example. Sangy foresaw the duel, and he accepted it as his fate, hence reality bent to make it happen. If he was like, "Nah, fuck that," then it's unlikely it would have happened. Number 10. The halfway there Primarch is Ferris the Manus. Sadly, Ferris didn't get a whole lot of screen time, cause you know, he got decapitated. But he still displayed some cool powers. His innate knowledge of forging and engineering was insane, and it only grew more powerful when he bashed up what could have been a Catan shard and absorbed its necrodermis into his arms and central nervous system. Yeah, the metal arms were pretty cool and they gave him a serious buff, but yeah, a bit of head choppy choppy kinda cuts, ba-dum-tsh, his lore short. Number 11 is the other missing Primarch, who is a master of Where's Wally, except that he is Wally and it's this page. Number 12 is the angry Angron, who has nails in his fucking brain. Worst superpower ever. Originally, Angron was an empath who could absorb and ease the sufferings of those around him, which he did to help his fellow gladiators sleep. But yeah, that ability kind of vanished when all he felt was suffering after getting the old brain nails. The brain nails also might have totally severed his connection to the warp, making him lose any other potential Primarch powers, as well as making him lose his Primarch aura, which is the thing that makes Space Marines shake in their boots whenever a Primarch is nearby. Yeah, the World Eaters fucking hated Angron. Number 13 is the big G-Man, Gilliman, the robot of Utes. Gilliman has like, no superpowers. His strength, speed, combat ability, and commanding skills are all decent, but not abnormally powerful. What he does have, however, is some mint-ass organization skills, and in a galaxy full of constant war and suffering, being organized gives you a huge edge over everyone else. What is Conrad's shadow stalking powers compared to Gilliman's ability to muster an armada within days? What is Jagged Eye's speed compared to a well-supplied and well-trained army? Each Primarch's abilities serve to make them a raid boss, whilst Gilliman's organizational abilities turns his armies into raid bosses. Just look at the effect Gilliman has had since returning to the setting. During the Horus Heresy, the Traitor's goal was to delay Gilliman from reaching Terra. The goal was never to turn him to Chaos or beat his armies, because both of them weren't going to happen. On to number 14, we have Morty, that smelly piece of shit. Morty was unusually tanky and could endure severe punishment. He also had an aura which gradually exhausted people, even ones that generally were immune to exhaustion. For example, in his fight against the Khan, landed a lot more hits, but Morty was able to tank them whilst gradually wearing the Khan out. He can also endure significantly more poison and toxins than the other Primarchs, but at the cost of looking like an ugly ass motherfucker. He also had a surprisingly solid stealth ability and could sneak past most people, and he was a psyker, but like, who cares? Number 15 is Big Red, Magnus the Big Red. Obviously, this dude's a wizard. Great wizard, shit listener. He can also change his size depending on the situation. Need to punch a titan to death? No worries. Needs to get through a low doorframe? No worries. Another ability is that his appearance changes depends how he's feeling. And he's not just the psyker, he's literally made of the warp. Like when Lehman snapped his spine, he didn't put Magnus in a wheelchair or physically disable him. He broke his soul. Probably would have rather the wheelchair, but oh well. Number 16, we have the big man, Horus. I'd like to say that male pattern baldness is his power, but it seems like half the Primarchs have it. Horus was a legendary warrior commander, but that isn't very special. What is special is his supernatural levels of charisma. After all, this dude convinced 9 Primarchs, beings of supreme intellect, as well as a ton of space marines, which are known for their genius IQs, to willingly sell their souls to the forces of hell and rebel against the Emperor for some pretty unconvincing reasons. Primarch 17 is the kitty fiddler, Lorgar. Lorgar was and still is the runt of the litter, but he did develop some snazzy skills over time. He unlocked his Psyker powers, which whilst they couldn't compare to Magnus's, still came in pretty hot. He too has some pretty significant charismatic powers, as he was able to convert multiple planets to a new religion in only a couple years. That charisma extends to his sons, who are unusually loyal to Lorgar, even for space marines. For example, when the traitors rebelled, each traitor legion had to cull about 1/3 of their legion due to loyalty issues. Lorgar didn't have to do this. In fact, when he did cull a portion of his legion, it wasn't due to loyalty issues, it was because he just didn't like them that much. Primarch 18 is Vulcan, who is stacked. Vulcan is the biggest Primarch, and arguably the strongest. He also cannot die, as he is a perpetual. Vulcan has been killed in thousands of creative and over-the-top ways, and he's always regenerated. He's also a master craftsman, and can make fucking wild shit that no one else can make, even if they were shown how to. Vulcan's greatest power, however, is that he is a good person. The Emperor was so proud of Vulcan to see that Vulcan maintained his humility when it seemed like all the other Primarchs had lost theirs.
Give this man a hug.
Primarch 19 is the Raven Raven, Corvus Corax. Corvus is a spooky dude with some spooky powers. He can straight up turn invisible, even in broad daylight, and he uses his ability to survive the Istvan Dropsite massacre. Corvus can also smell Chaos Corruption, as he killed a Wordbearer that was attached to his legion after detecting it within him. By far his coolest power though, actually no, by far the coolest power out of all the Primarchs, is his ability to transform into a gigantic shadow demon and wreck everyone's shit. One of the last times we see Corvus, he beats the shit out of Lorgar, again, by using this demonic shadow raven form, and by god, I'd love to see a tabletop model of it one day. Fuck it, maybe I'll just get one made. I'll call it Raven Raven. And finally, number 20, Alpharius and Amigon. Other than their ability to scramble my brain whenever I think about them, these dudes can give their blood to their sons. This greatly empowers their son, and it makes them think that they are Alpharius, hence why Alpharius seems to have died like 10 times now. These Primarchs can also hide their Primarch aura and blend it with normal Space Marines. Alpharius was present for most of the Emperor's meetings with each Primarch, but he was able to go unnoticed in the crowd. It's funny to think that as all the Primarchs come from the Emperor's DNA, hence the Biggie has access to all of their powers. OP as shit. If you enjoyed the video and you want to support the channel, then Patreon is the place to be. Only $1 per month give you access to a boatload of Warhammer hentai. Hit the subscribe button, then hit the real subscribe button for more Prime content. Join the Discord for more memes, and I'll see you in the next one. Peace.